My name is Ash, and I am an Ashmane. Close as I can figure it, the year is 2020, and Ashmanes are almost extinct. It wasn't always like this. He was a popular character. Once.
I don't want to use my Medal of Man. Nurse!
He's got the mind games. Oh, he's got the real mind games.
All of that changed one day, and things haven't been the same ever since. Ashley Joanna Williams, Evil Dead, Evil Dead 2, Dead by Dawn, Army of Darkness, Ash vs. Evil Dead. Prior to the release of the Ash vs. Evil Dead DLC for Behavior Interactive's Dead by Daylight, there was a lot of interest in bringing this character and the franchise from which he comes to the asymmetrical horror title. People had all sorts of interesting ideas for the killer and survivor possibilities this franchise posed. As you can tell from all of these images taken from the Dead by Daylight official forums, this was one horror classic people wanted to see. There were a number of different suggestions for the chapter. It posed something of a unique scenario in that it didn't have one consistent, singular, individual antagonist. It did have a singular, obvious protagonist, aside from the reboot film in 2013, which featured a female protagonist named Mia. And though it had been suggested that Mia could be a survivor option, most people suggested that Ash fill this role. The problem for the antagonist is that the main foe in Evil Dead media is a collective evil force which possesses the dead or living characters surrounding and including Ash. There have been a few larger antagonists, namely Evil Ash, who was a clone of Ash that progressively became more evil as Army of Darkness went on, and some of the antagonists from Ash vs. Evil Dead, the 2015 to 2019 Stars series, such as Ruby, the Dark Ones, Elagos, and Ball. However, when it comes to the excitement and speculation of an Evil Dead chapter, desires for the killer were varied. If any prevailed, I would have to say it was Evil Ash, which makes sense as Army of Darkness presents a very unique tone, slash time, slash aesthetic for DBD and has evil in the name. With all of this speculation behind it, people had a reason to be excited when this happened.
Right. So the goal is to then not be Dead by Daylight, right? Word solidify. Oh, hi. I didn't see you come in. I'm Bruce Campbell, best known as Ash Williams from Ash vs. Evil Dead. Good news. You get to play Ash as a survivor in the hit video game Dead by Daylight. Be Ash and survive. Okay, got it? Good. Now, my agent told me once I completed my contractual obligations that you had a little something-something for me. This isn't tequila, but what the fuck? Get somebody on the phone!
Get that flashlight the hell out of my face, Bruce. That shit hurts, man. I'm seeing those damn little spots. So, yeah. That was a fun way to reveal a very much anticipated chapter. I actually found out Ash was getting added in real life when I attended PAX East 2019. I also got to meet Brian David Gilbert of Polygons Unraveled. Not related, just a fun fact. Anyway, I was only vaguely aware of Dead by Daylight at the time, having played maybe 15 hours with my sister and a friend of hers. I also wasn't entirely aware of Evil Dead. I only knew it was something I wanted to check out because I would probably like it. Anyway, after I heard some news, I didn't understand and picked up a long-sleeve t-shirt that they told me was exclusive. It wasn't. The Dead by Daylight community went spinning the way it always does for new content, especially that which is licensed and thus heavily speculated on. Ash Williams from Evil Dead was going to be added to Dead by Daylight. And not only that, but Mr. Campbell himself was going to voice the character. I should also mention that the character was technically leaked prior to the PAX East announcement through his perks being available in KYF mode. Interesting, considering a very similar thing happened with the following DLC when the wrong build of the game was released to live servers and awkwardly unveiled the addition of Ghostface. But when the official announcement came, for every excited fan in the community, there was another confused as to whether or not there would be a killer. Amidst all this confusion were responses that this would not be the only DLC to feature only one character, nor the only licensed DLC to do so. More active members of the community pointed to the likes of Left 4 Dead's Bill Overpeck and Texas Chainsaw Massacre's Bubba Sawyer, and so these active members focused more on what we might expect to see from Ash and his perks. The chapter received mostly positive feedback, currently having a 77% positive review rating on Steam out of 611 ratings total. There were concerns regarding one of his perks, Medal of Man, which quickly became meta due to the high-reward, no-effort nature of its function. There was a penalty for using the perk, but it didn't prevent people throughout the community from using the perk constantly. On the whole, the hype that existed prior to the character arriving in Dead by Daylight made the paragraph rather successful, albeit not so much as, say, the Nightmare on Elm Street or Halloween chapters. Ash was given three perks, just as every character always has in the game's history. Flip-Flop, Buckle-Up, and Medal of Man. Flip-Flop is an anti-slugging perk, which converts 50% of your dying state recovery progress into wiggle progression upon being picked up by the killer at a maximum of 50% wiggle progression. Buckle-Up is an information perk, which indicates the recovery progress of dying survivors with chromatic intensity of their auras, and reveals the killer's aura to you and a survivor you recover should you pick someone up from the dying state. Medal of Man, however, is sort of a perk of its own type. It applies endurance to you when you enter the injured state and it has already activated, which happens when you've taken three protection hits. His perks nowadays are really very uncommon to see in random matches and are more or less relegated to Metal's place in a sabotage-centric build on Survivor, or the occasional anti-slugging build with Flip-Flop thrown into it. And then the dedicated Ash main such as myself, who uses perks for whatever reason. Metal is far less popular than it used to be, but it does probably still remain the most popular of Ash's perks. There is absolutely no doubt in my mind that Buckle Up is the absolute least popular of his perks, and perhaps the least popular of every Survivor perk in the game. The DLC also costs about as much as any other licensed chapter, but comes with only one character who is known for having very unpopular perks, so it makes a lot of sense that the DLC wouldn't appeal to hardly anybody nowadays other than Ash fans or those intent on getting every character in the game, which is honestly a pretty significant paywall nowadays. One of the highlights of the DLC, and definitely one that could have been a huge source of controversy had it not been an inclusion, was Bruce Campbell voice acting Ash in the paragraph. When you're in the lobby and you have Ash selected, he'll give a little bit of banter in that signature voice, with a total of 15 voice lines, though several of those are just extra takes of the same lines, so it works out to be more like 11 or 12 actual unique lines. Not only that, but his voice in a match is entirely performed by Bruce Campbell as well. Every little grunt he makes, every pained wheeze, every ridiculously loud scream is Bruce Campbell.
Look who's shitting in the tall grass. Mm-hmm. That's right. That's me, baby.
And it really sells that the character is Ash, which is very helpful as without a chainsaw or shotgun and with him constantly getting his ass kicked by killers like a Philip, Ash just sort of feels wrong. He's out of his element. He's hardly recognizable. So having the voice there is a nice little reminder that this is the same character we know and love. In spite of how exciting it is to have one of the most famous horror protagonists in the game, it contextually means a lot less without the iconic antagonistic forces that define him as a character and the series of origin as a whole. What is Ash without his Evil Dead to Versus? Without his chainsaw? Without his boomstick, even? He's just a famous weak dork. I mean, maybe that's a little harsh, but it's hard to deny that he isn't here in full or his fittest form. Maybe this little problem wouldn't even be worth noting if it weren't for the other franchises brought to the game, such as Halloween, Nightmare on Elm Street, and Left 4 Dead. All of those received some of the best treatments Behavior Interactive could offer. Sure, Nightmare on Elm Street's DLC definitely suffered from being based on the license for the 2010 film, And sure, there wasn't a killer for Bill either, but all of these series got as full a treatment as behavior could offer, and in comparison, Evil Dead seems to have just been shafted for bias. Yes, we got Ghostface shortly after we got Ash, but neither of these characters had to be crammed into a paragraph, and we didn't get a map for either of their DLCs. I do believe that Ghostface should have offered a survivor, even if it were an original one, like Carl, but I think that his paragraph is less offensive than Ash's because in the Scream series, the killer is instantly recognizable and easily the most marketable and memorable aspect of the series. Not to mention the design's origins in the original Halloween costume and the resemblance to the painting The Scream. Yes, it would be nice to have Sidney Prescott, and she's definitely a beloved protagonist, but Ghostface is just about as strong a character without Sidney as with. It's definitely a shame there's no map, too, but Ash not only didn't get a map, but was relegated to being old man Mr. Rogers Ash and having no Evil Dead to verses. It doesn't help Ash also didn't get a map, and he has quite possibly the most famous singular horror setting of all time on his side, the spooky cabin in the spooky woods. As a side note, I would like to mention that the lore provided for Ash's appearance in Dead by Daylight is appreciable and fits the Ash vs. Evil Dead tone, but it does leave a little something to be desired. Maybe it's just a little too easy. As much as I love Ash Versus, I wish that if it were to only be Ash as a survivor, it could have at least been one of the movie Ashes, especially if it's Ash from the first or second film. It would make his weakness and inability to kick ass make way more sense. Then again, what if they had just done the obvious thing and made Ash a killer? The Chosen One, a killer from the Evil Dead franchise. Ash Williams has no intention of killing innocent people. As such, the entity twists his prey into something they aren't, possessing them with a powerful evil, the Deadites. Though this may not give them the incredible power they might have had in Ash's past due to interference with Kandarian evil when within the entity's realm, Ash agrees to kill them on the entity's behalf. Though the entity did not select the demons for the trials, their extreme dedication to torturing Ash and their hatred for him, especially intertwined with Ash's matched hatred for the Deadites, is enough to warrant not interfering. With his chainsaw hand on hand, Ash saws right into the Deadite survivors to wound them, and shoots them down with his boomstick. His perks give him unending endurance, ironclad speed, and a fated connection with his opponents. In a way, little changed for Ash when he said, "Yeah, sure, why not?" to the entity. After all, he was bound to slay Deadites for eternity anyway. Okay, so it's rough around the edges, but I think this is a fun general idea for how Ash could have existed as a killer. I especially think it would be interesting to have the entity take him as a killer, and he denies the entity what it wants until the Deadites just happen to follow him to the entity's realm. I do wonder sometimes if perhaps there was a problem making Ash a killer, that they might have tried to make it happen, but encountered difficulty when approaching the license holders. Probably not, but it gives me some solace to think Ash may have once been a killer behind the scenes. Speaking of license holders, one of the significant things to point out about the Ash vs. Evil Dead DLC is that it is just that, an Ash vs. Evil Dead DLC. Not Evil Dead, not Army of Darkness, not even just Ashley Joanna Williams. Specifically, it was Ash vs. Evil Dead, a widely beloved but noticeably separated entry into the Evil Dead franchise. Obviously, there was a promotional element to the DLC, given that Ash vs. Evil Dead was yet to be cancelled as of the DLC's announcement, but there was also the licensing situation surrounding the franchise. If not for the revival, there would have certainly been more difficulty in trying to get the franchise into Dead by Daylight. Each film in the series has its own complicated licenses, and Ash himself is effectively legally separated into four pieces. It makes introducing him or any of his antagonists a bit difficult. Hell, the entries are so separated that I made a tier list of each Linda, and she's not even the main character. She was cast four times! So, sure, maybe Ash wasn't and isn't in the sort of legal hell that certain other classic horror icons like Jason and Freddy are, but he certainly comes with his own set of complications and road bumps to overcome. As such, we really only had any decent chance of getting Ash versus his Ash. However, in spite of that, it remains peculiar that we didn't get a killer. I suppose you could say they couldn't make room in the budget for a killer if we were to get Bruce Campbell's voice for Ash, but considering that Bruce Campbell is mostly known through his cult following instead of mainstream appeal, I sincerely doubt this was the case. I guess they may have just wanted to get Ghostface out so quickly so bad that they ended up leaving out a killer for Ash and made both halves of one pseudo-chapter. If there had been a killer for this version of Ash that we got, I think there would definitely be several prominent choices. Ruby is the main antagonist, and she certainly does a lot of evil shit, but her design doesn't necessarily lend itself well to a Dead by Daylight killer, and her gameplay would require a kit more diverse than anything we've seen in the past for this game. I think she'd probably wield the Kandarian dagger for her weapon and use her little demon babies to do her bidding, but there's a lot of ways to take it. Another major option would be Elagos, a villain that didn't stick around a whole lot in this show, but had a very cool design and was very prominent in the marketing for the series. He would honestly fit really well into Dead by Daylight and would easily be one of, if not the best choice for an Ash vs. Evil Dead originating killer. His power would likely center around short-distance teleportation and keeping information from the survivors. Maybe he could cause doctor-like hallucinations or take on survivor vessels. Perhaps he could make crows randomly startle around the map or prevent them from being startled. Whatever his power would be, it would be very interesting. And a third option for an Ash vs. Evil Dead killer would be Ball, an antagonist that only shows up later into the series but sticks around quite a lot and leaves an unforgettable impact. He has a vampiric aesthetic all about him, has hypnotic-type abilities, and overall would definitely just fit well into Dead by Daylight. Hell, they could even still just pick literally any Deadite or even just a generic Deadite and it would work fine. The point is, there's a lot of fun options and we ultimately got nothing. Not only did the Ash vs. DLC not introduce a killer, but it didn't introduce a map either. And you might say that Ash vs. didn't include an iconic enough location of its own, and while that's a fair enough point to make, in spite of Jacksonville and Ash's hardware store, it also included perhaps the most iconic horror movie location of all time. The cabin. Not getting the cabin is one thing, and it is really, really unfortunate, but even more unfortunate is that we then didn't get a map for Ghostface either. That's two of the most important and iconic horror icons of all time right in a row, with no map for either. And both of these had incredible options for maps. There were certainly options for Ghostface if he'd been associated with the Scream license, like the frat house, the college, or any of those sorts of locations. But of course, there was no such association. So instead, we'd have to do something original. I think the easy and obvious thing to do would be to have the convenience store we saw in Ghostface's reveal trailer. I mean, they have a whole aesthetic worked out just for a cinematic trailer. Why not put it to some use? Maybe it would be a little reminiscent of Gas Haven, but I don't think that matters. Even if they didn't do that, it would be nice if Ghostface had a place to call home, but him not having one makes not getting one for Evil Dead sting all that much more. With all of that out of the way, let's get back to the main thing the chapter was missing.
We don't owe the battlements! We will hold! We must protect the book!
If we were to simply disregard all licensing matters surrounding this long-running franchise that is Evil Dead, which admittedly is not an option behavior likely had, I believe the perfect choice for a killer to match Ash, should Ash still be made a survivor, would be Evil Ash. Armed with a mighty Kandarian sword, the evil can strike survivors down, slashing furiously and tally forth. A special attack he can access to tap into every so often to more easily and fearfully punish his opponents. Wherever the evil isn't, his armies are. Outside of Evil Ash's terror radius, members of the Deadite army will occasionally stir up trouble and slow down survivors in their attempts to complete objectives around the map. His design would be closely ripped from Army of Darkness, with his flowing cape, flayed flesh, and helmet constructed of bone and twine. He would have a few simple color swaps, but could also potentially have skins to turn him into Deadite Ash, the Evil Ash from Ash vs. Evil Dead, or even other characters from the franchise. All in all, I think Evil Ash would easily be a perfect fit for the game, while still introducing something entirely unique to him. How long is it going to take behavior to start tapping into more time periods, like medieval times, prehistoric times, or even more recent time periods that still aren't within the last 4 to 5 decades? Wouldn't everybody be excited to get a medieval chapter, Army of Darkness or otherwise? Maybe not, but I feel it would be very exciting all the same. As for what we did eventually get, what could we do to make it better?
Let's go.
It is no secret Ash has one of the absolute least popular perk sets of any Survivor or DLC. For $5, disregarding sale prices, you get 3 total perks that are extremely unpopular, situational, and generally regarded as useless. And while I certainly wouldn't agree that they're all useless, looking at you, buckle up, I definitely think it makes the DLC the absolute least appealing to everybody but dedicated Evil Dead fans. Not only that, but Ash himself is technically detrimental gameplay-wise if you care about how much audio a survivor produces or how large or stealthy they may be. I personally don't think he struggles with stealth. In fact, I think his blue shirt as a base with the prestige blood on it blends better than just about any other torso in the game. But I do run Iron Will on him quite a lot, so I would be quite the hypocrite if I were to claim he weren't the loudest son of a bitch. Even with Bruce Campbell's golden voice, it's hard to ignore how very, very loud Ash is in-game. But beyond those minor gameplay details, his actual perk set is at best very situational, albeit pretty fun in concept. So how do we go about making Ash's perks more relevant, more worthwhile, more interesting, more viable, if you're into that sort of thing? Well, it isn't especially simple, but the outcome ought to be simple to implement, should behavior get around to it. Let's start with Medal of Man. Easily the most popular of the three, this perk has a very specific application now. Sabotage builds. It can be used just for unhooks or randomly taking hits while a killer is carrying somebody, but mainly its current state is useful only for sabotage, as it will protect you once or maybe twice a match while you try to sabo the hooks the killer is going to. You generally want to get 2 tokens before you get hooked for the first time, or else you probably won't get any use out of it whatsoever. A lot of the potential the perk has is based on getting certain kinds of killers. The kind that don't know how to play around it, that is. It's not really a perk with much synergy outside of general sabotage builds, so just think saboteur, breakout, that sort of thing. I should also bring up the fact that you can run Mom with We're Gonna Live Forever, so you can get a token on that for each Medal of Man token you get. There's no practical synergy there, but it's worth mentioning. Another thing I should mention is that when they changed the perk to only count protection hits, they never removed the really problematic downside for activating and using the perk. When you take that hit whilst having endurance, your aura is then shown to the killer if you fully heal, and remains revealed until you are downed. This downside is really extreme for a perk like this, in that it has a very strict requirement for activation, and gives you very little for what it is. It requires a whole supporting build and playstyle, gives you only 1 total health state, and then punishes you for using the perk at all. Compare this perk to something like a Styptic, or Decisive Strike, or Borrowed Time. There are so many ridiculously easy ways to get a health state, and none of those punish you for doing so. That's not even mentioning the fact that you'll be an obsession, the aura of whom the killer can see from far away. What do you think they'll assume if they see that? They won't assume you used Medal of Man, will they? No! They're gonna think you have Ooh, and they're gonna tunnel you for it. Now, I do think Ooh should be effectively removed from the game, and if they did that, this problem would no longer exist. But the downside would still be very extreme for such a difficult, situational, and unrewarding perk. If it were up to me, the perk would have the number of protection hits required lowered to 2 or even 1, and the downside removed. Or leave the downside, but make it regular hits and change the number of hits required, or the ability to use the perk multiple times, or how many times you could use it. I don't know. There's honestly a lot of combinations of changes you could do to this perk. I'm not sure if any of them would make it a good perk, but I guess if they wanted one easy fix to it, it would be lowering the number of hits to 2 and removing the downside. That would still leave it as a very situational perk that required a supporting build and play style, but it would at least help you activate it a bit. Next up, buckle up. This perk, well...
Hai sera l'anime me ne saliette, tu sai adò. Adò, sto cuore ingrato più dispiette,
far me non può.
Oh, oh, oh.
So, what can we do? Well, there's a lot of ideas out there for how to make Buckle Up a real perk. People have suggested effects similar to Soul Guard, i.e. buffs for you and the survivor you pick up, should you fully recover them from the dying state, and completely separate perk ideas like speed boosts or ranged pickups on downed survivors. I think we'll try to stick to the themes currently present in the perk, as that's what Behavior would likely do if they were to alter the perk. So, you've got teammates being slugged. You're to step up to the task, and you've got just the perk for the job. But in all the uncertainty that comes with a scenario like this, what does the perk do for you? Well, maybe it could apply an effect to survivors picked up near you, similar to Flip Flop. This would punish the killer for immediate pickups and combo well with Breakout. You crouch nearby, hoping to get the pickup with We're Gonna Live Forever, but the killer won't budge. So you have to try and stay unseen instead, in the hopes that your Buckle Up procs and the down survivor recovered, the latter of which you would know thanks to the aura reading the perk provides. I know this may be a bit frustrating to play against, but honestly it would be really situational and not especially useful. It just sounds like a fun idea to maybe play around with and refine further. I'm not totally against the idea of healing down survivors from a short range either, but I'm not exactly sure how they would go about making that fair and animating it. I'm sure they could, but I don't know where to begin on theorizing how that would go. You could keep the current effects, but strengthen them. I don't think that would really change the perk's popularity or perception, but it would at least help push it in the right direction a little. Somebody suggested it receive a kindred treatment, where it applies to the whole team if you're downed or just in general. This would be nice, I think. Still not very useful, but makes running it quite a bit more justified. Another suggestion people have put forward is that it increase healing speed of downed survivors by a significant amount. This is thematically pretty obvious, and I think it's a good idea. However, this buff was given to We're Gonna Live Forever, so it isn't very likely it will be added to Buckle Up anymore. I would like if, instead of that, it increased recovery speed for nearby survivors in the dying state. This would be really fun against killers that soft slug if everybody had Flip Flop and Buckle Up. There's a lot of ways to take a perk like Buckle Up forward, but I suppose that's mainly due to the fact it does almost nothing at all right now. And last, but the opposite of least, my personal favorite, the perk to end all perks, my savior, my holy grail, my anti-slugging deity, Flip Flop. This perk is definitely the most exciting of Ashes, and in general, to use, even if Medal of Man is far more common and popular, and practical. It basically never does you any good, but it requires a very subtle mastery to get value out of it, and though I have mastered the process of getting value out of this perk, it still only works when the killer slugs. Luckily, I'd say this currently happens in around 1 out of 3 to 5 matches of the game. It helps if you know what motivates the killers to slug. If you can die in front of a teammate, or worked on gen, or even after throwing a pallet, it is more likely that the killer will slug you, even if for just a moment. I think if there are changes made to this perk, they should be extensive, but simple and straightforward at the same time. An obvious change would be one-to-one conversion up to something like 85% wiggle progression. I think the perk would be fine that way. It still wouldn't be very popular, but it'd be more likely to gain value from if you did use it. It might make it take a little less skill in terms of positioning, but that would be an alright trade-off in my opinion. This would just make it the right kind of anti-slugging perk, the kind it deserves to be. Then again, it would also make it much more obvious what happened when it procs. As it is, if you wiggle off due to flip-flop in any amount, it isn't really clear that it was a flip-flop play, so you might get away with doing it again. That being said, you could just recover the amount you think appropriate and then tell everybody with Buckle Up. At the end of the day, all of Ash's perks are very strong concepts, but play out in a way that is very disappointing. I really hope behavior does take the time to rethink them, as it wouldn't take much effort to implement some of these concepts.
This path will lead you to an unholy place. A cemetery. There the Necronomicon awaits.
Well then, how would Behavior Interactive go about giving us changes like the ones I've put forth in one move? How would they tie all of these ideas together if they were to try and do such a thing? Well,
good. Bad. I'm the guy with the gun.
Army of Darkness. The chapter we need, even if it might not be the chapter we deserve. I guess it wouldn't technically be a chapter so much as a paragraph, but it would really be between the two. The main piece of content this update would add is Evil Ash as a killer, ideally with his power I described earlier in the video, but I'd be excited no matter what he did or how he worked. Alongside Evil Ash, this would bring on the Kandar realm, giving us two total maps, the cabin and the castle. It would introduce two different styles under one realm. The cabin would be somewhat similar to the forested maps we have, but with a road and a trail, as well as denser trees. Hopefully there would also be dead leaves all over the ground. The cabin would ideally be a little larger than it seems in the films, but it wouldn't be a huge issue if it wasn't. To prevent this from technically being a paragraph, and to make it feel more important, it could also come with an Army of Darkness cosmetic set for Ash Williams. It could have the chainmail cape, the light blue shirt, the greasy 90s hair, the muddied pants, and his cast iron prosthetic hand. All of this would also hopefully come with changes to Ash's perks, be they as I described them or otherwise. Hell, maybe they could even add a couple voice lines to Ash that they had previously cut out or something. Maybe they could just give Bruce a ring on the old telly and ask him for a couple. I don't know, just an idea. Honestly, I don't think it would be too difficult for behavior to make something like this happen, but they'd have to care about it enough, and given the history of their treatment of Evil Dead, well, I'm not getting my hopes up. Also, check out this render of Army of Darkness Ash. Can you imagine seeing something like this in-game? It wasn't made for Dead by Daylight or anything, but can you imagine?
Repeat them.
Klaatu Verata Nyctel.
Again!
I got it! I know your damn words, all right?
So, there's just a few extra things I want to cover before we wrap this up. Firstly, at the time of this recording, the new perk Power Struggle makes any buffs to flip-flop very unlikely, as the interaction between the two is directly tied to flip-flop itself. If they gave flip-flop one-to-one conversion, no matter the cap, Power Struggle would become inherently and immediately problematic. Or the two of them in their interaction would. Additionally, I do believe it is somewhat possible Ash's perks will receive changes at some point, given that they're apparently trying to review the chapters that they've done one by one in a modern context and with a modern perspective. That being said, they've already changed Medal of Man a lot, and Flip-Flop is constrained by Power Struggle now, so really only Buckle Up has a strong chance of any significant change. Additionally, the new Evil Dead The Game trailer does lead me to believe that there is a small chance we'll receive Army of Darkness content in Dead by Daylight, seeing as how that's coming out next year and will unify all of the rights in the Evil Dead franchise, but it does still remain doubtful. I really hope they do more for Ash someday, but who knows if they will. Also, if you're going to use flip-flop and boil over, which is a popular concept, best to do it on Kate, technically. Most people will assume you're full anti-slug otherwise, say if you were to do it on Ash, but on Kate, they'll think you're just using her perks for the hell of it. And I have a bunch of really, bizarre screenshots of Ash. I'll put them in a channel on my Discord if you want to see more.
Groovy.
Obviously, I have spent a lot of this video putting a negative lens over Ash's place in Dead by Daylight. But I guess I am glad that he's here at all. I think it's just very frustrating seeing my favorite franchise get shafted in comparison to some others by a company I want so badly to trust and appreciate. It often feels like a deliberate disrespect for or hatred towards something I really love. Regardless of that, I'm glad that I finally said what I had to say, and, thank you for watching. I mean, this was a lot of work to put together. I've been working on this for 2 months. but thank you so much for sticking with me. Follow me on Twitch, subscribe here, join the Discord. You can always rely on me to give Evil Dead the respect it deserves. Probably more than it deserves. Anyway, my socials are in the description, and I'm going to be doing a bit of Lego game stuff on Saturday on Twitch. If you want to stop by and check that out, that's this Saturday, the 19th, December 2020. You can forget all about that if you're watching this down the road. Thank you for tuning in, and I'll catch you on the flip-flop.